Heavenly Father, we thank you and bless your name for the retreat of this year. Thank you for keeping your people alive to see such a day like this. We thank you, Lord, because you prepared so much for us. And your people are going to receive abundant blessings at this December retreat in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that you open every heart to your word. Open every life to your blessing. So that, Lord, every word will do us good in Jesus' name. As we are concentrating on readiness for Christ's return, we are praying, O Lord, you prepare every one of us. Get us ready. We pray, Lord, that none of us will miss that glorious and blessed day in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, that all the grace we need, all the strength we need, all the power and the blessings we need to carry us through until that final glorious day you give to every one of your children. Bless us, Lord, and make us channels of blessings for all the people. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I welcome every one of you to this December retreat in Jesus' name. As you know, a lot of preparation has gone into preparing for this retreat. In your personal life, I'm sure you are prepared. And in your zones and districts and everywhere we've come from, you've had the announcement, you have had the publicity, and you know that we're expecting great and wonderful things from the Lord. And I pray that none of us will be disappointed in Jesus' name. We thank you for coming and appreciate the fact that you are here. But now you must make the best use of being here and all the locations where we are, and we're having this retreat together. I pray that God himself will open the heavens upon us and shower abundant blessings, innumerable, unlimited, upon every one of our lives in Jesus' name. In the children camp, in the youth camp, in the campus camp, and also in the adult camp, I pray that none of us will be careless and none of us will miss what the Lord has prepared for us. As the leading message for this retreat, since we're talking about readiness for Christ's coming, we're looking at the word of God on the certainty of his coming. He did promise that he'll be coming, the prophecy of his coming, and then what we need to do, how to get ourselves ready by the grace of God and in the strength of the Lord. We're looking at the message, constant readiness for Christ's return. Constant readiness for Christ's return. To start with, you want to understand. You want to be very sure that the word of God has given us this revelation that Christ is coming. If you look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, reading there from verse 9, this is when Christ went up to heaven from the mount. And the disciples saw him, and then angels appeared. And these angels declared that this same Christ is coming again. Acts chapter 1 verse 9. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they were looking steadfastly toward heaven, because that's where he went, and that's what he promised he will do, he said, I will go and prepare a place for you. He's gone to heaven to prepare a place for his own people. And they were looking up steadfastly to heaven. And they were told the cloud received him out of their sight. And behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. These were angels. And they announced to them that Christ will be coming again. In verse 11, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here, gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, the one who died for us, the one who has saved us, the head of the church, and the one who promised to be coming again and he went to heaven, this same Jesus, which is taking all from you into heaven. The angels did not leave any doubt where Christ had gone. He's been taken up into heaven. But he gave us assurance, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. He repeated that again. He's gone into heaven. He's coming again. There's a certainty. There is assurance that Christ is coming again. In Revelation chapter 1, reading here from verse 7. Revelation chapter 1 verse 7, behold, he cometh with the clouds. He's coming. The assurance is there. But looking at Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2 verse 25. It tells us in verse 25 what we need to do, how we need to get ready, how we need to be prepared, because he's coming. It says, but that which ye have already, you're born again, you have something. You're saved, you have something. You're sanctified, you have something. You have the power of the Holy Ghost in your life, you have something. You have the Word of God, you have something. It says, that which you have already, hold fast till I come. It tells us, gives us assurance there, he's coming. In chapter 3 and verse 11, behold, I come quickly. Behold, I come very soon. Behold, I am coming. The imminence of his coming, the nearness of his coming, the certainty of his coming. It says, behold, stop and think about this, that I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that nobody, that no one will take your crown. It tells us in chapter 16 and verse 15. But looking at this, so you can be sure in your heart that Christ is coming. And as you have the assurance in your heart, the conviction in your heart that Christ is coming, you will see the necessity of preparing for that coming. Revelation chapter 16 and verse 15. Behold, I come as a thief. That means he'll come suddenly. That means he'll come unexpectedly. That means he'll come when people are sleeping at night. That means he will come. He'll come without any announcement. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watches and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and see his shame. If you're a believer in the Bible, if you understand the word of God, there'll be no doubt in your heart whatsoever that Christ is coming again. It tells us in the very last chapter, chapter 22, reading here from verse 12. Chapter 22 verse 12, and behold, I come quickly. Have you seen how many times the Lord gives the assurance that he's coming, and he's coming very soon, and he says it is imminent. He uses the word quickly. I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his reward shall be, according to his work shall be. In verse 20, as we close the New Testament, it says, he will testify these things, says, surely, no doubt in heaven, no doubt in the heart of believers, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus is coming. And actually, when he was here on earth, he emphasized to his disciples and emphasized to all the people who believed in him that he is coming. But then he said, his coming should be prepared for, that those who love him, those who know him, and those who want to partake us of the blessings of the Lord when he comes, we need to get ready. And he gives us illustrations too, and tells us what happened before. When something like this, a great event, was announced, was prophesied, before it actually happened, there were people that were not ready. There were people that were not prepared. And because of that, he reminds us with those historical events in the Bible that he is coming and we need to be ready. Constant readiness. Now that we know the Lord is coming, we need to get ready and we need to have that readiness constant. Every day, expecting the coming of the Lord, knowing it could be this day that the trumpet will sound. It could be this day that the dead in Christ shall rise. It could be this day that the saints will be taken up away from this earth. And because we don't know when it will come, that's the reason why you need to prepare every time and be ready every time, every day, every moment of your life. In Matthew chapter 24, here is what Jesus reminded us of: the event in the past that was announced before that event took place, and the people, many of the people, were not ready. They were surprised when it happened. Matthew chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 34. Matthew chapter 24, reading from verse 34. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Obviously, you understand, Christ, I've been talking about some things happening. What will happen in the nations? What will happen in various kingdoms? What will happen even ecologically? What will happen to the surface of the earth? What will happen in every way? And he said, when you see all those things happening, like many things happening in our day, it says, you understand, the time is at hand. And it says that all this is happening will show you that that coming is imminent. In verse 35, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. He's telling us here that it's useless and irrelevant. It's useless and unprofitable setting dates, saying it's going to come this particular day or this particular month. It just tells us, get ready. It will come at a time you're not expecting. That day, that hour, that time, that moment, the date, nobody knows but my Father who is in heaven. It says in verse 37, but as the days of Noah, so also shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Noah had announced, because God had told him, that a great event was going to happen, that judgment was coming upon the earth, and that only those who are ready, only those who are prepared, will escape that judgment. He announced it to his world. He announced it to the people around him. But many of the people did not take what he said seriously. And Jesus is saying, in the same way as it was in the time of Noah, even so it shall be at the time of the coming of the Son of Man. It says in verse 38, for as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, they were marrying and giving in marriage. Nothing wrong in eating, nothing wrong in drinking. But that was their preoccupation. That was the totality of their lives. They were living for food. They were living for physical things. They were living for things on earth. And Jesus said, as it was at that time, marrying and giving in marriage, all they could think about those days, the pleasures of the flesh and the things in marriage, having children, raising children. It says that's what they were doing, they were preoccupied in, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And he knew not until the flood came and took them all away. Listen to this sobering statement at the end of verse 39. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. It says already we have an event that wants us, an event that should judge us, an event that will tell us we need to prepare. It happened to them. And Jesus said so, in such a way, in such manner. And the same way it surprised those people, and that flood came to them unannounced. It will happen. So shall it be. So shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Verse 42. Watch therefore, and for ye know not what hour your Lord does come. He calls us to watchfulness. Verse 44. Therefore, be ye also ready. That's the readiness we're talking about. This is a message Christ himself will want us to meditate on, to pray on, and to examine our lives, and to find out how ready am I, how prepared am I for the coming of the Lord, for the young and for the old, because that coming will come for everyone. Verse 44, therefore, the word therefore is means, that means because of all this that I've said, and because of what is going to happen, and because of the danger of not being ready, and because of the perdition that will come on the people that are not ready. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour, as ye think not, when you are thinking, I don't think it will be today, I don't think it will be this time, I think the way things are now, the Lord, you might have some reasons in your mind why you think it cannot come now, it cannot be this period. That's why he says in that verse 44, he says, in such an hour, as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. He calls us to watchfulness. Mark chapter 13. In Mark chapter 13, reading from verse 28, here you'll find that Mark, by inspiration, is telling us the same thing. But he looks at another perspective here. Mark chapter 13, reading from verse 28. Mark 13, 28. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When her branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is near. The Lord was giving his explanation, illustration to those that were his immediate audience, immediate congregation. They were farmers, most of them, and they knew that the season could easily be predicted by what was happening to their crops. And so he told them, when you see that the branch is yet tender and is putting on leaves, then you know from experience, you know from observation, you know from all the things that have been happening, that the summer is near. Then he says, so ye in like manner, when ye shall see these things come to pass, that is all the events I've been talking about concerning church, concerning religion, concerning nations, concerning all the events on the sea, the waves of the sea, the roaring of the sea, and concerning all the earthquakes. It says, when you hear those things happening, then you know that it is near, even at the door. And as you listen to things happening around you, you will know that the coming of the Lord is very near, even at the door. It says in verse 30, verily I say unto you, that this generation, the generation that sees all those things happening, all those events happening, this generation shall not pass till all these things be done. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. It's telling us that there are some people that will think that maybe God has changed his plan. He has changed his mind. Maybe because it has taken so long in their own evaluation, estimation of how long is. They think it might not happen again. But it says heaven and earth will definitely pass away, but his words shall not pass away. But of that day and that hour knowest no man. No, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, But the Father, yes, the angels know that it's coming. They don't know the time. They do not know the date. And he knew he'll be coming back. But the Father has reserved that in his own knowledge, that he knows exactly when. That's why the Lord said in verse 33, because it's a day you do not know, a time you do not know, an hour you do not know. You know that he's coming very soon, imminent. He'll come anytime from now, yet you don't know the exact time. Verse 35, verse 33, take heed, watch and pray, for ye know not when the time is. But the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey. He's going to heaven, who left his house and gave authority to his servants. He left his house, he left the church, he's going to heaven. He's giving authority, assignment, duty, responsibility to his servants, to the apostles and the preachers and the members of his household, members of the church, and to everyone his work. He's giving us something to do while we're waiting for the coming of the Lord. And he commanded the porter to watch. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at evening, or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly, mark that word, coming suddenly, when you were not prepared, he comes, he finds you sleeping. And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. What I say unto you, what he said to those disciples and apostles before him, listening to him, he says unto all, and he says, watch. He says, get ready. He says, get prepared. He says, look at your life and look at where you are spiritually, and see what the Bible has said, and see the qualifications it's expecting, and see the condition, spiritual condition he expects in your life. And then you watch, and you take heed, and you take care to make sure that you're ready for his coming. And you do that constantly. You do that every time. You're expecting him. Therefore, you're examining yourself, and you're finding out, am I ready? And if he reveals to you at any time that you are not ready, you want to make sure that you repack your load, readjust yourself, and seek the face of the Lord so that you will be ready. And I pray that the Lord will grant us that spirit that is alert, that is getting ready and staying ready every time, in Jesus' name. Are you there? I said he'll get us ready in Jesus' name. Amen. Constant readiness for Christ's return. There are three things we're going to look at before we pray. Number one, the world and its people before Christ's return. What will the world look like? What will the world around you, the community around you, the neighbors around you, what will they be doing? What will they look like just before the return of the Lord? The world and its people before Christ's return. Number two, watchfulness and preparation for Christ's return. He's telling you that he is coming. And because he is coming, you need to watch and you need to prepare. You need to do something. There are many people that think, since he's coming, let him come. It's not just like that. If you're going to benefit by that coming, if you're going to receive the blessings of his coming, and if it's going to take you to heaven as he promised, there is a preparation you need to make. Watchfulness and preparation for Christ's return. Number three, the wonder of preparedness. Those who are ready, The wonder of preparedness for the church's rapture. The church's rapture. When he comes and he takes the church away, and he takes the saints away, the wonder and the blessings that will be ours. Number one, the world and its people before Christ's return. We're coming back to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. I'm reading from verse 36. Matthew chapter 24, verse 36. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. He's telling us now the conditions of the world at the time of Noah, and he compares that to the time of his coming. And he says, as those days of Noah were, what they were doing, and the state, spiritual state in which they were, he said, even so it will be at the time of the coming of the Son of Man. Then he gives us the details in verse 38. For as the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking. All they could think about is, how will I eat? What will I have? What will I wear? What job will I do? And as you think about the world in which we're living today, that's a preoccupation. We go to school, nothing wrong in that. But many people have no other thing doing. Get educated. Get a job. Build a house. Ride a car. Raise a family. That's all they're looking for. And there are some people that even associate with the Christian faith. And they go to one church or the other, and all their preoccupation, all their prayer, all their desires, anything they're asking every time relates with, what are we going to eat? Where are we going to live? Who are we going to get married to? When are we going to have children? And Jesus said that was it at the time of those people in Noah's day, eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And he said, they knew not until the flood came and took them all away. It came to them by surprise, and they all went through that flood, and they all perished because they were not living for any other thing. Notice, it's not just talking about their iniquity or their sin or their evil. Is talking about their preoccupation. Let's look at the condition of things at the time of Noah. We're looking at Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. And I'm reading from verse 1. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, beautiful. And then it says, and he took them wives of all which they chose. That's what Jesus was talking about. He said the men of this world at the time of Noah, all they could think about is look for a beautiful lady and get married, raise a family. And then for the women, look for an handsome man and get married and raise a family. That's all they were thinking about. And if you look around you today, where do people go to church? What do they pray? What do they fast? What do they appear religious, almost fanatical in their zeal and passion, saying they're seeking the Lord? They're not seeking the Lord for his glory. Most of the time, they're seeking the Lord for what they can have. And he says, and the Lord said in verse 3, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. The Lord told them, there is a limit. Marrying and giving in marriage, there's a limit. Eating and drinking, there's a limit. Training yourself and getting a job, there's a limit. There's a limit to all that in your life. A limit to which you can go. Because a time is coming when the marriage will not be profitable. A time is coming when the work will not be useful. A time is coming when the material things of the world will fail you. And then it goes on to say in verse 4. It says, there were giants in the earth in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. There are many people today, all they can think about is, my children, they go to college, my children, they get a profession, my children, they have this, they have that. That's what's their preoccupation at that time. And then it says in verse 5, and God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thought of his heart was only evil continually. They were not thinking of righteousness. They were not thinking of seeking the face of the Lord so that they could be saved, so that they could have eternal life, so that they could have the grace of God in their lives. Repentance was out of their mind. Righteousness out of their mind. Living according to the grace of God, according to the plan of God, out of their mind. Look at that verse 5 again. God saw. What does God see in your life today? In your family today? In your neighborhood today? And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. The world is getting worse and worse. Righteousness is absent. Holiness is absent. Even as you go from religious camp to another religious camp, you'll find that there's no righteousness. The grace to live God in godliness is not there. And what God saw at that time, that's what he sees today. But don't go too far. Look at your own heart. Look at your own environment. And look at your own family. And look at your own condition, spiritual condition. You might be religious. Are you righteous? You might go to church. Are you born again? Are you living the life that is showing that you are ready for the coming of the Lord? And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thought of his heart was only evil, and that continually. Verse 6, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. Why? Because the purpose of creation was not being fulfilled. He created man so that man will be like him, will look like him, will think like him, will act like him, so that his life, his behavior, so that his comportment and conduct will be righteous and holy and pure, because he made man in his own image. But man had gone the other way. And that's what you find today. You find people all around you, and it might be yourself as well, that you're not living as God wants you to live. That's why the judgment came upon them, and that's why the judgment is coming today. It gripped him at his heart that he had made man. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repented me. That means he regretted it, that I have made them, but now I found grace in the eyes of the Lord. That's what we need today. If we're going to get ready for the coming of the Lord, we need that grace. The grace for salvation. and the grace for a holy life, the grace for a righteous life, the grace for sanctification. He purifies our hearts. He makes our hearts attuned to his heart. He makes us just like him, like he wants us to be. That's the grace we need today if we're going to be ready for the coming of Christ, the coming of the Lord, the coming of our Savior and Lord. We're looking at Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 28. We're looking at the condition of the world, the character of the world at the time of Christ's coming, just before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because it says, it's like it was in the olden days. It tells us in Luke chapter 17, reading here from verse 28. Luke 17, verse 28, likewise also. It's saying also, because it's giving us an illustration already. Illustration relating to the time of Noah. Illustration relating to the time of the flood. It says, here is another illustration. Here is another example. Here is another event that took place those days that will be very similar to the time of the coming of the Lord. Verse 28, likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold. That's commerce. And if you look at the commercial situation of the world today, it's like that's the only scene. We're watching the, you know, the rise of the dollar and the going down of the local currency. And we're looking at that every time, investigating every time. We're thinking about the market. We're thinking about the companies. We're thinking about what to do and what not to do. We're thinking of how to run the race with the people of the world and meet up with commercial demands. It says they bought and they sold, they planted and they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Have you noticed that in all these situations? Have you noticed that in all these events? Have you noticed that in all these historical things that Jesus Christ was making allusion to, only very few were saved. Only very few escaped. But the majority of the people, they perished in the flood and they perished in the fire of Sodom and Gomorrah. And Jesus Christ is saying, so shall it be at the time of the coming of the Lord. You might feel that the majority is doing this. The majority is sinning. The majority, even though they are religious, they're living in sin. And you might think it's all right. No, it's not all right. All those people will perish when Christ comes. All those people will be left behind when Christ comes. It's always the few who are saved, the few who are righteous, the few who are holy, the few whose heart is totally linked with the heart and the mind of the Lord. The fire came upon them and they were all destroyed. Even thus, even so, shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. Verse 32, remember Lot's wife. Those were the very words of the Lord Jesus Christ. It says there'll be backsliders. The people you seek would have escaped. The people you seek, they've seen angels. They've seen revelation. They've heard the word of the Lord. They knew the judgment was coming. They heard the warning. Look not behind you. Escape to the mountain. Let me show you that story. It's in Genesis chapter 19. Because Jesus said, read that story. Look at that story. Analyze that story. It's going to be exactly like that when Christ comes again. And then he tells us, remember Lot's wife. I'm reading from Genesis chapter 19 verse 1. It says, and there were two angels that came to Sodom. It said there came two angels to Sodom at evening. And Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. And Lot seeing them rose up to meet them. And he bowed himself with his face towards the ground. And after doing all that, greeting them, accepting them, welcoming them, he told them to come into his house. The angel said, no, we're here on an errand. We're here to do something the Lord has told us to do. But eventually he persuaded them, and he came to his house. Look at verse 4. But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house round, both old and young, all the people from every quarter. And he called unto Lot, and said unto him, where are the men which came in to thee this night? Bring them out unto us, that we may know them. That's where the word homosexuals come in. Sodomites, that's why the word is used for them. These were men, and the angels appeared like men. And they said, we want to know them. They wanted to mess them up. And then Lot went out at the door unto them, and shut the door after him. He was pleading with them, don't do such an evil thing. But they were bent on doing evil, just like the people of today. Look at it now from verse 9. And he said, stand back. And he said again, this one fellow came in to sojourn, and he will needs be a judge. Now will we deal worse with thee than with them? And he pressed Saul upon the man, that is upon Lot, even Lot, and came near to break the door. They were so bent on wanting to mess up those angels that looked like men, that they wanted to break the door. Look at verse 10. But the men, that is the angels, put forth their hand and pulled Lot into the house to them, and shut the door, and dismote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great. So the angels smote them with blindness. That's to drive them away, so that they will not discover where the door is. You know, they were so bent on wanting to do evil. Look at the latter part of verse 11. So that they wearied themselves to find the door. They still wanted to find the door. Judgment came upon them. Even with the appearance of that judgment, with the blindness that came to them, they still wanted to get into that place and mess up those angels. That's how wicked they were. And that's what the Lord is telling us. As it was in the time of Lot, so shall it be at the time of the coming of the Son of Man. The people will be so bent in doing, wanting to do evil. Even when they see the judgment of God coming like this, they still want to commit evil. Look at verse 15. And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city. And while he lingered, even Lot himself, he was lingering. He saw that these were angels. He saw that these were mighty angels. He saw they could easily smite those Sodomites with blindness. He knew that they came from heaven. They came from the Lord to destroy the place. And he was warned, come out of this place. Still, he was spiritually sluggish. He lingered. The men laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters. The Lord be merciful unto him. And he brought him forth, and set him outside without the city. And it came to pass, when they had brought them forth abroad, that he said, escape for thy life. Look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. Those were believers, but they were told the danger was still there. They ought to prepare themselves. They ought to get ready. Escape to the mountaintop. Escape so that you'll not be consumed in the fire coming upon the unbelievers and the sinners. Look not behind you. You remember Jesus said, remember Lot's wife Why did he say that? Look at verse 26. But his wife, Lot's wife, looked back from behind him and became a pillar of salt. She could have been saved, but she perished. She could have escaped, but she couldn't escape because Sodom was in her mind. All the treasures of Sodom, all the pleasures of Sodom, all the evil in Sodom, all the lust in Sodom, all the sensuality in Sodom, all the immorality in Sodom, all the nightclubs in Sodom, all the things pulled her back. And because of that, she looked back. And Jesus said, even so shall it be at the time of the coming of the Son of Man. And he tells us, remember Lot's wife. The people that love the world so much, they love the things of this world so much, that even though they hear the trumpet sounding, even though they hear the warning coming out, even though they know that it's so dangerous loving the world or the things of the world, they're so much attached to the world, it's difficult for them to break off. I pray that at this time the Lord will be merciful to every one of us in Jesus' name. And he will take our mind, our heart, away from the world. Anything that will make us not to be ready. In James chapter 4. James chapter 4, reading from verse 4. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world, communion with the world, fellowship of the world, interaction with the world, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world will be the enemy of God. That's what happened to Lot's wife, and she perished. That's why the warning of the Lord is coming to us. It says, get ready. The world is evil. The world is sinful. And only those who will come out of those evil things of the world, only those people will be saved, rescued. They'll escape on that final day. Luke chapter 21. In Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 34. Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 34. And take heed to yourselves. These are the words of Jesus Christ. If there were no danger, there will be no warning. But he warned his own disciples, and he's warning his own church today. Take heed unto yourselves. He's warning every believer today. Don't mix with the world to the point that you forget. You have a place to go. You're a pilgrim here on earth. And if you're so entrenched and meshed in the things of the world, you'll perish of the world. It's warning us. And it sounded the note of warning very clearly. And it says, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time, lest at any time, what time is it in your life when you could be so careless and forget yourself? What time is it in your life when the world could get so near and you'll forget the warning of the Lord? What time is it in your life when all the things that surround you will try to deaden you towards spiritual things? It says, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life. And the cares of this life. And the cares of this life. Cares of this life will make you forget that you're on your way to heaven. Cares of this life will make you forget that whosoever is a friend of the world is the enemy of God. The cares of this world will make you forget that those things will make you unspiritual, will make you carnal, will deaden your soul, deaden your spirit, deaden your life, will make you unprepared, not ready for the coming of the Lord. Take heed unto yourselves, lest at any time the cares of this life come upon you. You're so involved with the cares of the life, and so that day come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, watch ye therefore, watch ye therefore, and pray always that she may be accounted worthy to escape all the things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Revelation chapter 18. The Lord is calling upon us that because of how the world is, sinful, sensual, evil, immoral, you cannot stay in the world, agree with the world, go along with the world, and still make it on the final day. That's why the warning is coming. Revelation chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 4. It tells us, "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people." You want to be saved? Come out of her, my people. Out of those nightclubs, come out. Out of the drunkenness, come out. Out of their fornication and adultery, you come out. Out of their cutting corners and giving their bribes and receiving bribes, come out. And out of the evil things, the adultery, the idolatry, and the occultism, it says, come out. Out of dressing like them, talking like them, eating like them, drinking like them, it says, come out. Out of all their secret societies, it says, come out. It says, come out of her, my people, that she be not partakers of her sins, and that she receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven. The sins are so great, they're so numerous, and they're so very diverse, that you cannot even begin to number them. It says their sins have reached unto heaven, so great and so high, and God has remembered her iniquities. And for you to escape the judgment that will come upon the people on the face of the earth when Christ comes, you need to come out of the world, and come into the salvation of the Lord. Point number two now, watchfulness and preparation for Christ's coming. We know Christ is coming, and we know the condition of the world when Christ will come, and we need to get ready. That's why we need to watch. We're coming to Matthew chapter 25. The Lord Jesus himself, who prophesied is coming, who promised is coming, the Lord Jesus Christ himself, who reminded that the disciples that this world is not going to be the end of all things, that Christ will come. He will come. He'll take the people to himself. He warned these people. He called these people to watchfulness. And he's calling you and me to watchfulness so that we will be ready at the time of his coming. And then he says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. I pray that you'll have ears to hear. I said you'll have ears to hear. You'll watch and be ready in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 25, I'm reading from verse 1. Matthew 25 verse 1. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. They all believed doctrinally that the bridegroom was coming. But that wasn't enough. There are many people that believe that Jesus Christ is coming doctrinally, but that's not enough. Watchfulness is necessary. Preparedness is necessary. Readiness is necessary. It says in verse 2, and 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. Could you be waiting for the coming of the Lord and be foolish? That's what he said. Could you believe that Christ is coming and still be foolish? That's what he said. Could you actually read from the word of God, Christ is coming, and still be foolish? That's what he said. He said 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. It tells us in verse 3, and they that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. Talking of the grace that saves us, the grace that sanctifies, the grace that pours the oil, the anointing, the unction of the Holy Ghost upon us, the oil that gets us ready so that our lives, our lamps will be burning and shining. It says, these foolish ones, they took their lamps, the lamp of profession. I'm a Christian. I'm a member of the church. I'm going to heaven. I believe Christ is coming. I believe heaven is real. I believe hell is real. They believe doctrinally, but they didn't have the experience that will qualify them to be ready. In verse 4, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. The wise were the people that said, I know, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, and he get born again. The wise are the people that say, I know, follow peace with all men, and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. And they prepare themselves, and they get holy. The wise are the people that say, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God, and I want to see him when he comes. And they make sure they are pure, they are holy, they are sanctified, they are ready for the coming of the Lord. In verse 5, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Remember, it was Jesus Christ talking to his own disciples. Remember, what we're reading here came out of the mouth of the Lord Jesus Christ himself, telling us some people in the church will not be ready. Some people who are religious will not be ready. Some people who know about the coming of the Lord will not be ready. And he challenges us. He says, be a wise virgin and get oil in your lamp and get oil in your vessel and be extra careful to be ready and to prepare yourself. Get rid of all the things that hinder you from being fully prepared. There at midnight, there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. Our lamps are gone out. Not enough oil, not enough grace to resist temptation, not enough grace to overcome temptation, not enough grace to keep away from sin, not enough grace to move on in the strength of the Lord and be an overcomer, not enough grace to keep righteous and remain holy without blemish, without spot, until the coming of the Lord. Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye out rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. We cannot share salvation from the closest person with us. The salvation we have is only enough for us. We cannot share the holiness experience with the nearest person, closest person to us. The sanctification experience you have is only enough for you. You cannot share your self-denial with the other person there. It's only enough for you. We cannot share the power, the authority to overcome the devil, overcome sin with another person. You go out and get it yourself, and get it in good time before it is too late. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready, notice that, they that were ready, they were ready because they were saved. They were ready because they were righteous. They were ready because they were holy. They were ready because they met the qualification that Christ expected. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. That's why the word of God says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. Let the wicked man forsake his way, and the righteous man is thus. Let him return unto the Lord and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Afterward, in verse 11, came also the other virgins. Those are the foolish virgins. The people that were not ready when they ought to be ready, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Are those not backsliders? I know you not. Are those not the people that in the corridor of the church, in the veranda of the church, they're so near the church, but they're so far away? I know you not. And are those not the people that call him Lord, Lord, and they don't have genuine salvation? I know you not. And are those not the people that have heard about the coming of the Lord, and yet they'll not prepare their hearts and their lives? I know you not. Are those not the people that know the Bible? They know some verses of the Bible, but they do not have the experience that the Bible says we must have to make us ready for his coming. And Jesus said, I'll tell them, I know you not. Look at the conclusion in verse 13. Watch ye therefore, watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. Is calling us to watchfulness, and is telling us that we must be ready, we must be prepared. What gets us ready? What gets us prepared? John chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 3. John chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 3. Jesus answered and said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Obviously, if we're going to be ready, we must be born again. If we're not going to be like those foolish virgins, we must be born again. If we're not going to be disappointed on the final day, there must be that new birth. Become a new creature in Christ. It's a real change coming upon your life. Total change coming in your heart and in your soul. And you become very different from what you were before. Verse 5. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. Those who are fleshly, they're not born again. Those who are still involved in the works of the flesh, they're not born again. Because whosoever, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. Except that happens, how will you see him on the final day? We're looking at Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, watchfulness and preparation for Christ's return. Hebrews chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 37. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 37. For yet a little while, it will not be long. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. He's saying that Christ is definitely coming. Christ is surely coming. He says, a little while, very soon, Christ will come. He that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith. He says, those who are living by unbelief, those who are talking unbelief, those who are behaving unbelief, and those who are acting like the people of the world, like unbelievers, they will not make it on that day. Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. If anyone draws back, the people that feel that once you are saved, you are forever saved. And they do not understand the word of God that says if anyone draws back, if anyone backslides, if anyone goes from the kingdom of God and he goes back into the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of sin, the kingdom of evil, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we're not of them who draw back unto perdition. Those who draw back, those who backslide, they draw back unto perdition. But and it says, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. What's he telling us here? He's telling us that if you are giving to strife, if you're giving to contention, if you're giving to disunity, If you're giving to a fighting in your own life, in your own family, you're not following peace and you'll not see the Lord. If all you're giving to is argument and debate against the doctrines of the Bible, against the word of God, against the ways of the Lord, you're not following peace. And when he comes, you'll not be ready. What do you do to be ready? To settle those quarrels immediately. Settle those conflicts immediately. And settle all that strife immediately. And follow peace. But says, that's not enough. With all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. It's saying that we need to be holy. The sinner is not holy in his conversion. The backslider is not holy. He needs restoration. And the carnal one that is going to church or coming to church and still carnal, still doing evil, and you cannot tell whether he's here or there, is not holy. Holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. You want to see him when he comes. You want to behold his glory when he comes. Here is how to watch. Here is how to get ready. Here is how to be prepared. You follow peace with all men. Not with some men, all men. And then you follow holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Lest any man fail to have the grace of God. Lest any man fail to have sufficient grace of God that keeps you righteous, that keeps you holy, that keeps you prepared, that keeps you centered and focused on the coming of the Lord. It says, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness, any root of hatred, any root of animosity, any root of malice, any root of anger, any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator, lest there be any adulterer, lest there be any profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. There are people who count precious things cheap. The people who count their salvation so cheap. The people who count eternal life so cheap. The people who count their birthright so cheap. They'll give it up at any price, at a little price. The price of food, the price of a meal, the price of a job, the price of dressing, the price of having a husband, the price of having a wife, the price of having children, the price of having healing. They count eternal life so cheap, they can give it up. I need this, I need this, I need that. And because of the pressure of that need on them, like Esau, for one morsel of meat, they sell their birthright. For ye know how that afterwards, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. That tells us something. Crying alone doesn't show repentance. Crying alone, shedding tears, it may be tears of regret, and the tears of being discovered, and the tears of the shame, the reproach that comes upon you, because now you have degraded yourself, because you have disgraced yourself, because you have kind of defamed yourself. That's why you are doing the crying, not because you are so pained that you fell into sin and you need to get back so quickly. It says that Esau, even though he sought it carefully with tears, he couldn't have it back because he didn't find a place to genuinely repent. It tells us in Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, those who will not be ready and those who will not be watchful enough. And the Lord is telling us all this so that we will be ready. I pray you'll be ready in Jesus' name. It tells us in Luke chapter 12, verse 15. He said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness. Take heed and beware of covetousness. So and so has this, I must have it. So and so is succeeding, I must succeed that way. So and so is getting so much salary, I must have that. So and so has this possession in life, I must have that too. Jesus Christ said, You might forget the coming of the Lord. You might forget how you need to get ready. And you may be fighting for other things and struggling for other things instead of the real thing. Take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. More houses, more property, more certificates, more lands, more cars, more money, more whatever. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of the things which he possesses. You can become a slave to money, a slave to possession, a slave to those material things that have seized your heart. Take care, take heed, beware of covetousness. Adding this to that, adding one thing to the other. It says, beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. And he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to lay to bestow my fruits. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. I will pull down my barns and build greater. If you're the one that's always building, you build one there, that's not enough. You build another one there, that's not enough. You have a company there, that's not enough. I need another company there, that's not enough. You have property there, that's not enough. I must have this property, that's not enough. Your preoccupation in life, your kind of concentration in life, is adding things things to things. It says, I will pull down my barns and I will build greater. And there, then I will say, then will I bestow my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, a God is not in his heart. The thinking of God, the thought of God, readiness for the coming of the Lord. He thinks everything here is going to last forever. But you're going to leave everything one day. It says, I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. How many are those years? He thinks he's going to live forever. Many, many years. It's like, that's what many people are thinking about. They don't think life will ever end. They don't think it's necessary to prepare for the coming of the Lord. And even though they might come to meetings like this, it's so I can still have this and have that and have that. I thank you, Lord, I've got this. I'm counting my blessing. And then I still want this. I still want that. What are you going to prepare for heaven? What are you going to prepare your soul for the coming of the Lord? It says, you have those goods laid up for many years. Take then, eat and drink and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool. Who is a fool? The one that has wisdom to amass wealth might be a fool after all. The one that has knowledge enough, wisdom enough to have many certificates might be a fool after all. The ones that has wisdom enough to be able to raise business even overseas might become a fool after all. The one that has the business acumen, I can get anything done even in this generation when it appears economy is going down, I can raise that up and raise that up. I can start a new business anytime. He has that wisdom, might be a fool after all. God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be that thou hast provided? And Jesus makes the application now. He says, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. And that's why the Lord is telling us we need to be ready. Look at that same chapter 12 and look at verse 34. In verse 34, it says, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. If you have too many things here that you appreciate, that you cannot give them up, you cannot consecrate them to the Lord, your mind will be there, your heart will be there. It's like, even if God said, you're ready for heaven, I'll come up higher. You say, God, please, don't take me away yet. I need to enjoy this, I need to enjoy that. It says, where your treasure is, where will your heart be? Those are the things that are pulling you back from the coming of the Lord. It says, let your loins be girded about and your light burning, and you yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return. He's coming back. He will return. He returned from the wedding. That when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily, I say unto you, that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And then he tells us, and if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, that's talking about either midnight or 3 a.m., and find them so, blessed are those servants. And this know, that if the good man of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched, and not have suffered his house to be broken through. Be ye therefore ready. That's the conclusion. That's what he's telling the believer. That's what he's telling you. He said, wake up and be ye therefore ready, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when ye think not. At an hour when you don't think. Get ready. In Revelation chapter 16, reading from verse 15, Revelation chapter 16, reading from verse 15, calling us to watchfulness and preparedness. Revelation 16 and 15. Here the word of the Lord is still telling us that we need to be awake. It says, behold, I come as a thief. It will be sudden, and yet it will be sure. Blessed is he that watches and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and see his shame. We've looked at the fact that Christ is coming, and we've seen what the scripture says, that we need to be ready, constantly prepared within the condition of the world, that it will be as it was at the time of Noah and at the time of Lot. And those who are kind of wedded to the world, in friendship with the world, they will not be ready. And he wants us to come out from among them. And he wants us to get saved. He wants us to get sanctified. He wants us to be filled with the Holy Ghost, so that we'll have all the grace we need, all the strength we need, all the power we need, so that we can be conquerors and conquer self, and conquer sin, and conquer evil, and overcome every temptation that may come against our lives, and be like that until he comes. We're looking at number three now. Point number three, the wonder of preparedness for the church's rapture. The wonder of readiness for the church's rapture. The word of God tells us very clearly that as Enoch went up without seeing death, as Elijah went up to heaven in chariots of fire without going through the portals of death, even so the church, when Christ comes for the church at the time of the rapture, will go from this world without going through death. But then he tells us we need to be ready for that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading from verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, He says, we might not know a number of things in this world, but here is one thing you must know. Here is one thing you must be sure of as a brother, as a sister, as children of God, in the family of God. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, those who have died, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. It tells us there's going to be the resurrection of the dead when Christ comes. It says God will bring those who have slept in Christ, those who have died, and he died as real believers. It says when Christ comes, God will bring those ones with Christ. Then he tells us in verse 15, for this will say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord. It says he's coming, and there are some of us that are going to remain, and we're going to remain alive until he comes, until the coming of the Lord. We shall not prevent, precede, or hinder them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise forth. The dead in Christ, those who have died, but they were in Christ when they died, they'll rise forth. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. What a wonder, what a glorious scene, to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's the wonder of it when Christ comes, if you are ready. That's the wonder of it, if Christ, when Christ comes, you're saved and you keep saved. You're sanctified and you keep sanctified. You're at peace with all men, you remain at peace with all men. You do not allow any conflict to come into your life. You do not allow any root of bitterness or hatred or malice or anger to settle down in your life. It says those of us who are ready at his coming will be with the Lord, ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. It tells us in Matthew chapter 24. At the after the rapture, there'll be the great tribulation. Those who miss the rapture will go through the great tribulation. What sorrow, what suffering, what heartache, what pressure, what peril, what evil they will go through. The wonder of all wonders when you escape that great tribulation. Wonder of all wonders when the great tribulation does not come upon you here on earth. Matthew chapter 24 and verse 21, for then shall be great tribulation after the church is taken away, after the church is raptured, after those who are ready, the wise virgins, those who are saved, those who are righteous and holy, those who are pure and godly, after they have been taken away to be with the Lord in the air and forever to be with the Lord, then shall be great tribulation such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days shall be shortened, there should no flesh that's among the Israelites be saved. But for the elect's sake, those Israelites, for the Jews, the elect of God, those days shall be shortened. It says then, if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not. For there shall arise false Christs. Religions will rise up. People who claim to be working miracles will rise up. It says, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and it shall show great signs and wonders, in so much that if it were possible, they will deceive the very elect. If your mind is only on healing, only on miracle, only on signs and wonders, you could easily be deceived. And there will be those who will be deceived on the final day. as we're getting ready, getting near the coming of the Lord. Because all they're looking for, I see miracle there, I see wonders there, I see this there, I see this there. And they're running about and they're not getting ready, getting prepared for the coming of the Lord. And Jesus said in verse 25, behold, I have told you before. He's saying, take warning, I've told you before. I will refer to the event of Noah. Let's come back to Genesis chapter 7. How did it happen at that time? And Jesus said, in the same way, it's going to happen. In the same, exactly the same way, it will happen when Christ shall come. Genesis chapter 7, I'm reading from verse 1. Genesis chapter 7, and we're looking at verse 1. And the Lord said unto Noah, come thou and all thine house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. The people who will miss the who missed the flood, the people who did not perish in the flood, they were the people that God found righteous in that generation. In this generation, the people that will miss the great tribulation, the people that will go up with the Lord Jesus Christ, and then they will escape the great tribulation, they'll be the people that God finds righteous in this generation. And after Noah got into the ark with the family, see what happened in verse 16. And they went in, and went in male and female of all flesh, as God had commanded him. And the Lord shut him in. The Lord shut the ark. Time of grace for the rest of the people was over. And the time of seeking the face of the Lord was over, because they were not wise. Not wise unto salvation. Not wise unto readiness. Not wise unto getting prepared for the coming of the Lord. Those that were ready, they went into the ark, and the Lord shut them in. And the Lord is saying, it's going to happen exactly the same way. That's why you want to examine yourself. Are you ready? That's why you want to examine yourself. Are you prepared for the coming of the Lord? That's why you want to examine yourself. Are you righteous or reprobate? Are you obedient to the word of the Lord? As the Lord found you righteous in this generation, that if the trumpet shall sound at this time, you will know by the grace of God you are ready. He's coming. And only those people who are saved, and they are made holy, they are made righteous, and they are walking in righteousness and holiness in the private and the public, anywhere and everywhere. Those are the people that will escape the judgment and go with the Lord. In 1 John chapter 3, reading from verse 1. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. As many as believed him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even those that believed on his name. What wonder, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not. Therefore the world is not friendly with us, and we are not friends of the world. Therefore the world knoweth us not. We do not partake of their festivities. We do not partake of their idolatry. We do not partake of their sinful pleasures. They don't recognize us. They don't want us. They don't appreciate us. It says, therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. If you are known by the world, accepted by the world, appreciated by the world, recognized by the world, praised by the world, honored by the world, I'm not sure you're ready. I'm not sure you're ready. If the world befriends you and you befriend the world, if the world recognizes you and you recognize the world, if the world is appreciating your life and you appreciate the world, it's like you are into them and they are into you. It says, so will not be ready. Those who will be ready are the people that the world will say, what kind of people are these? Away from the world. Well, you don't fit in here. Yes, we don't fit in because we are pilgrims. That's why it says we're called the sons of God, and therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, that's talking about his coming, that's talking about his return, when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. That's the wonder. Our resurrection body will be like his glorified body. We shall see him even as he is. And he says, every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Why do we purify ourselves? Because we want to see him. Why do we remain holy? Because we want to see him. Why do we get saved? Why do we get born again? What do we have new life? What do we maintain that new life? Whether it's in the secret or in the public, because we want to see him when he appears. Why do we get sanctified, get holy, and remain in that righteousness and godliness? Because we want to see him when he appears. We're not doing it because we're members of a particular denomination or a particular church. The people that have a wrong notion, a wrong idea, okay, because I'm a member of this particular church, I'll get saved, I'll get sanctified, not because of that. I'll get holy and remain holy, not because of that. Or because, if I don't do this and don't do that, then they will know and they might, question me. Not because of that. Because you want to be ready when he comes. It says, every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 7. What it takes to be ready, and the wonder of being ready, the glory of being prepared when he comes. Revelation chapter 19, reading from verse 7. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. The bride has made herself ready. The believers have made themselves ready. You need to make yourself ready. It will not just happen. You need to pray. You need to repent. And you need to come and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. You need to be pure. And you need to be made holy by the cleansing of the blood. You need to walk in the light as he is in the light. And you need to know that it's the knowledge of the word of God. It's the knowledge of the truth of God. It's the power in the word of God that comes your life and turns everything around and changes your life. And you need to get ready, because it says the bride of Christ, the people of God, those who are expectant and those who want to be ready when he comes, they are the people making themselves ready. You need to push everything aside, and you need to abandon anything that will hinder you. You need to look at your life and look at those details of your life. What is it that you love more than God? What is it that is of the flesh, is of the things of the world, is of the pursuit of this life that you want to get rid of? And then you get rid of them. You speak unto the Lord in prayer. You really make supplication. You make this period a time of seeking the face of the Lord. It's not a time, I only want to be healed, I only want a prosperity, I only want this, I only want that. But you really want the spiritual experience. It says the wife, the bride, has made herself ready. And then it goes on to say, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, cleaner and white. And it says, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. It takes something to be ready, brethren. And it takes a watchfulness. It takes that you watch over your soul. It takes that you watch over your Christian experiences. It takes that you examine yourself once again and find out, am I ready? In Revelation chapter 22, verse 12. Revelation chapter 22, verse 12. And behold, I come quickly. That's Christ talking to the bride. And behold, I come quickly. That's Christ talking to the church. And behold, I come quickly. He wants the church to wake up. He doesn't want us to sleep with the world, or to be dead with the world, or to be associated with the world. He says, behold, I am coming. And think of all the events that will come, that will appear, that will happen at the time of my coming. Behold, I come quickly. and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments. Blessed are they. They examine their lives and they see areas they have not been obeying the commandments of the Lord, and they say, I want to be ready. I want to be ready when he comes. And blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. He's taking us to heaven when he comes. Already he said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if it were not so, I would have told you. He said, when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you unto myself. That is to the heavenly city, to the holy city. That's why it says we must be ready. What if you are not ready? Look at verse 15. For outside, without, are dogs. Outside are dogs. That's the picture of immoral people. That's a picture of licentious people. Outside, without, are the dogs. That's the picture of the barking, snarling people, shouting people, debating people. That's the picture of defiled people. It says, without are the dogs. And the sorcerers, the witches, the people that have familiar spirit, no, they cannot make it on that final day except you repent, except to turn away from that witchcraft and sorcery. And the unmongers, those are the fornicators, and those are the adulterers, those are the effeminate people, those are the sodomites, and those are the people that are fleshly and sensual. And it says, and the murderers, and the idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. It says, some will be ready, they are saved, they are sanctified, they are pure, they are righteous, they are godly, they'll be ready. But those, there are those who will not be ready. They're still in their sins. They're church people, but they live in sin. They're religious people, but they live in sin. They say they know the Lord is coming, but they have not been washed and cleansed and set free from their sins. When the Lord comes, they will miss the coming of the Lord. It says, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offering of offspring of David, and the bright and the morning star. And the spirit and the bright say, come. The spirit is still saying, you can still come. Come into the fold. Come into the grace of God. You can still repent. You can still call upon the name of the Lord. You can still be washed in the blood of the Lamb. You can still come out of sin and come to the Savior. The spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, the door is open. Whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. It's available. The door is still open. Salvation is still available. Restoration is still available. Sanctification is still available. Holiness is still available. A change of heart transformation is still available. The grace of God is still available. And you can come to the Lord even at this very moment and say, Lord, I want to be ready. When the Lord will come, and the Lord will make you ready. I said the Lord will make you ready. You turn away from sin, you turn away from evil, you turn away from the flesh and all the works of the flesh. And then you bring your life to Calvary and to the cross again. And say, the blood of Jesus that cleanses from all sin, do the work of grace in me. He will do it. I said he will do it. The spirit and the bride say, come. Let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst, the one who is thirsty for righteousness, and the one who is hungry for righteousness, let him come. Because the Lord will fill him, and whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. You'll come to the Lord. I said you'll come to the Lord. You'll come even now. And the grace we need to be ready at his coming, and not to be lost with the people of the world, that grace the Lord will give unto us. Let's rise up and let's seek the face of the Lord and say, Lord, I come. Lord, I come. Lord, I come. Are you saved? Make sure you are saved. Are you sanctified? Make sure you're sanctified. Are you ready for the coming of the Lord? Make sure you're ready for the coming of the Lord. He wants you to be ready. That's why you came to the retreat. We didn't come just to come. We didn't come just to fulfill, you know, the yearly event. We came so that we can be ready. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord. He'll make you ready.